Alrighty, guys. From a dark basement and a haunted dwelling somewhere in a black swamp of Northwest Ohio, this is Swamp Gas, and I am your host, Arizona Tramp. This is also the place where me and my granddaughter love to have fart wars, by the way. But anyhow, this is going to be an action-packed great show for you that I got tonight, and we're just going to jump right in and talk about what's going to happen. I have Bronxville Paranormal people here from the Paranormal Society, and they went to Nuclear Lake. And this show is all about what took place there, what happened with the people. Well, let's just put it this way. There's four people here I have with you tonight. We have a man named Brian Baldwin. We have Bill Skywatcher, who you all know. We have Al Santariga. I'm sorry, Al. I don't know how to pronounce your name.
Santariga.
Yes.
Santariga.
I have Cindy here. And we are going to just start the show off. And I'm going to ask you, Al, how long has your paranormal group been together?
We've been together for over a year as the Bronxville Paranormal Society, but you know, I had another group of friends that I would go out and do investigations with, but I decided to put a serious group together, you know, people who are really weren't in it for the thrills, but people who are really in it for the science and trying to figure out what the hell's going on the other side. And
right.
And I, you know, we all met Bryan and Bryan Bowden, who is my executive. I want to get this right, Bryan. My executive director of technology and paranormal research. Bryan is my right hand man. I couldn't do anything without him. We met through a group called the UFO Roundtable, and there's a bunch of other people in the group who aren't here with us tonight. If you wouldn't mind, I'd like to give a shout out to the rest of the team.
Go for it, and you give a shout out to whoever you want to, bud.
Thank you. First and foremost, it's my brother Frank Santariga. Frank is our parapsychologist, and my sister Marilyn Aiello, who's our team intuitive. We have Cindy Ann Schulster, who's our team editor and recce master. Paul Greco, who's our team's special advisor and team consultant. Anthony C., he's our team's lead investigator. Bob A., who is our team's resident videographer. And Alan D., who's the team's historian. And then we have Cindy Bailey Dove, who's the team's psychic. And Bill Forte, who's an honorary member and our reserve videographer whenever we need him. and that's my whole team. And we go out and we go to places of, you know, high strangeness, and we do our investigations, and we bring a ton of equipment with us, and we go old school, new school, and a little bit of everything, and it never really fails. We always get something. We always tend to get something, you know, and Cindy always advises us. We always have Cindy read the place first to see what we're walking into, you know, 'cause there have been times where she's read, you know, dark energy at one of the places we planned on going to, and we decided not to go there. It was just not worth coming home with something dark.
Well,
and
what's the hardest thing about being a paranormal group?
Getting everybody together to go out on a team, because we're all working people, you know, so it's almost impossible to get everybody to go out on the investigation. Someone's always working, and someone's always got, you know, family stuff to do. That's the hardest thing to do, honestly, to get everybody to go, you know, schedule everybody at the same time.
That would make sense to me. It's kind of like trying to keep a band together after everybody gets married.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's so, one of the hardest things. Absolutely. Keeping everybody on the same page. I think we've ever done an investigation where we had the whole team together. We came close once, but not quite everybody.
Wow, that would be one hell of a show. Have everybody here on at once.
Oh, that would be, yeah, I know, it would be impossible to have everybody on at once. I got you. But, you know, so the whole thing came about as I've done a couple of Sasquatch investigations at Nuclear Lake. Like I said, it's a place of high strangeness, and I heard of it through a neighbor.
Well, hang on a second, up a second. Once, why is it called Nuclear Lake? Because I bet you nobody else in the room, in the chat, and who's on radio even knows about it.
Let me get this right. There was I wrote it down. I got my notes here. Bryan, you want to jump in?
Sure.
I know you got it off the top of your head.
Welcome to the show,
I'll jump
Bryan.
A while ago, United Nuclear Corporation was given a special permission by the United States military to work with weapons-grade material, radioactive material, and the purpose was to look for a way of for transportation purposes. What they're transporting, I don't know, but that's what they were licensed for, and apparently they had a very nasty accident and explosion. A lot of people got trapped, a couple people got killed, and there was a lot of weapons-grade uranium put into the lake. A little bit later on, that they swear, the government swears, and I'm putting quotes up, that they cleaned everything up. But that's to be determined.
How do you clean a mess like that up totally?
They dredged the lake. They dredged the lake. That's what they did. Just to correct Bryan, I think if I got this right, the place, there's actually a uranium mine on site, and they were mining uranium, and I think what they were doing was refining it when the facility blew up and everything spilled into. I think it was plutonium or whatever it's called, plutonium, actually went into the lake.
What year was this?
1972.
Okay. Way back in 72. That's why.
Yeah, way back in 72. Absolutely.
That's why nobody remembers it.
Well, you know, like I said, I've done some investigations there and had some minor success as far as the Sasquatch stuff goes. And I told Bill about it. And, you know, Bill's like, well, you know, Bill's a dear friend of mine. He lives real close to me. And he's like, we got to go. Okay, so we went out. I took him out to Nuclear Lake, and it's a mile hike in. And we got up to the lake, and we were there about 2 minutes. Bill, we heard a tree knock.
Yep.
2 minutes, heard a tree knock. Bill says, "Well, what do you think that was?" And I said, "It sounded like a tree knock to me." And I pulled out one of my meters, and it said that there was an entity in front of us and an entity behind us. So I says to Bill, wouldn't it be funny if the Sasquatch in front of us is telling the Sasquatch behind us that we're in the middle? No sooner did I say that. Now, Bill's filming. I think Bill actually caught that knock on his video. A rock comes flying over towards me and Bill from behind us, from the west side of the lake. And Bill says, "Well, what do you think that means?" And I said, "I think that means it's time for us to move."
Well, how did we know it was our way. Was there a smell? Did it make a howling noise, or did it just knock?
Oh, not yet. Not that.
No.
I just got to say something before Al continues.
Go ahead, Bill.
Now, this is the first time I ever went on any kind of, I would say, a paranormal or even a cryptozoological expedition, like for Bigfoot. You know, for this kind of topic, this, you know, what they were going for here. Now, when we first got there, Al had the ghost app, and the first thing it said before we were just reaching the grounds, like, there's a gate that you got to go to get to the main path that gets to the lake. It's an old road. I guess it's the old mining road. And the app says being. So right away, I'm getting a vibe. As soon as we're going into the place, I'm getting a vibe that, first of all, we're being watched. And I got this uneasy, like, hair rising thing, going on
the back of your head. Yeah.
So then Al points out these walls that, you know, these structures that were constructed by maybe in colonial times or by Native Americans. I don't know. There's a lot of history there involved with these structures of these walls, and they go all over the place around the lake. Then he also points out this tree that supposedly a carcass of a deer was carried 50, 60 feet up, and this tree had no branches. I mean, it just went straight up, and then at the very top, there was this one branch. And Al was telling me of a story that they seen something up there. They had gone there previously, and he was telling me the whole story. Then when, that's when we got to that rock. And like he said, the app was telling us something was going on in front of us, and then we hear that rock being thrown behind us. And that's it. It already started. It already had a, you know, everything was already starting to go. And then Al, tell him about where we went to afterward with the footprint.
Were you starting to freak out, Bill, or what?
Nah, I was excited because this is what it's all about. I mean, right from the get-go, and I have to tell you, Al has a history of paranormal stuff going on, and it goes down back to his childhood, and I think it's all connected. But he has this sense and attraction that I think, personally, things are attracted to him. So I'm just going to put that out there from what I got as my own observation and from knowing Al and, you know, speaking with him and about his experiences and his accounts in the past. But I felt right from the get-go, I knew this was going to be an interesting day, to say the least.
Right. Go ahead, Al. I'm sorry for interrupting.
And the funny thing, Arizona, I was just taking him there to see the lake. We weren't really going there to do an investigation. He was just going to film the park, because technically it's a federal park. The Appalachian Trail crosses right in there. And we were just going in. I was just going in to show the place. I didn't expect us to have anything happen. It was in the middle of the day. It was like 11 o'clock in the morning. So we start walking, and I tell them, you know, I tell them some history about the campers who have had Sasquatch experiences on this one particular area where the Appalachian Trail comes out and comes into the lake. There's like a little campsite there, and who was ever in that area always seems to have a Sasquatch experience. So we go to this area, and at this point it hadn't rained in a long time and the lake was low. And man, I swear we found a left footprint in the mud in the lake. And we were both like, is it? I don't know. Could it be? You know, it looks like a left footprint. I got a size 13 work boot, and I was wearing my work boots, and I put my boot next to this, and Bill was filming it. He's got this all video on his YouTube page.
Yeah, I saw the video.
And you know, my foot is small compared to this footprint. And then, you know, he's like, Al, show me where the Appalachian Trail is, which is directly across from this campsite. And I brought him into there, and no sooner than we get in there, I started pointing out trees that were broke, like from wind and rain and ice and storms like that. The difference between a natural broke branch from bad weather compared to one that a Sasquatch will twist and bend, because they usually do it to saplings. And we're in there, and we're looking around, and I'm explaining this thing, and all of a sudden, right behind Bill is this makeshift shelter. I mean, just right off the trail. I mean, it was ridiculous. I mean, we couldn't believe what we found. It wasn't the kind of shelter that would support any kind of shelter for anybody hiking in the woods or sleeping on the trail, because it just was too shabbily made. And we moved on, and then we found this one that was like how do I explain it? Like a teepee almost, and its branches weaved between other trees. And I'm not talking little branches. I'm talking branches that are like 6-8 inches thick, 20 feet long. And we're filming everything, and Bill is freaking out. He can't believe all this stuff we're finding. And we head deeper into the woods, and we're hiking, man. We're like got like 4 miles in, and we're hiking on the Appalachian Trail, and we come across this stone figurine thing. I didn't know what the hell it was. I've seen him before up there, and the very first time I seen him freaked me out, because I wasn't sure if it was devil worshippers or Native Americans or what, but I knew there hasn't been any Native Americans in the area in a long time. So we were checking that stuff out, and eventually we got to the east side of the lake, and we found these three giant quartz crystal stones. I mean, all the other stones in the woods are what's the name of those stones, Brian? Help me out here.
They're called the Nookashooks.
No, not the Nookashooks.
The Karens. They're called Karens.
Right, the Karens.
Karens? You're talking about the quartz crystal?
Yeah, I'm talking about the regular stone in the woods. What is limestone? Everything on the mountain is limestone. And here we have these three round crystal stones, and they're in the shape of a pyramid. and I naturally touched one on the top and it fell over, and we laughed. Bill said, now you got like 10 years of bad luck. And we laughed, we goofed about it, and he said, man, we got to come back here again. And I was like, okay, you know. And he goes, let's do it on Halloween. And we had already had something planned for Halloween. We're going to actually go to these ancient stone chambers that are built up here in the Northeast. They're all over. Nobody knows who built them and whatever. And so anyway, Bill talks me out of doing that, and we decided to go to Nuclear Lake because, A, it's a place of high strangeness. It's Halloween, right? There's a full moon. There's a meteor shower. And it's like the perfect storm. So I call Cindy and I say, hey, Cindy, you know, what do you think is going to happen? Cindy, you want to take it from here?
Yes. I had been writing things about what was going to happen at Nuclear Lake for almost 3 weeks. But I had told Al one of the main things that was going to happen is that he had to watch the other team members because people were going to be disoriented, might even fall, because the energy was so high at this place. I also told him that they were going to be followed by a Bigfoot type creature from the time they came in to the site, was going to be watched till they left. I also felt that they were going to see light anomalies and have a, there were going to be times when they felt like that they had basically been touched by something or energy. And I was talking about the, I could see all of these, I guess what I call them, shrines that people have put up over the years all over this place.
Right, right.
And so when he called me, well, you can go ahead and tell him how he was going to build this, this on top of these stones. He was going to put his crystal skull and a Tibetan singing bow.
Right.
So pick it up from there, Al.
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. So now it's Halloween, and Bryan decides to come up from the city, and he meets me and Bill, and we head out to Nuclear Lake. And you got to get in there during daylight hours because you're not allowed at the lake at night. But you are allowed on the Appalachian Trail 24/7. So we hiked in mid-afternoon around 4 o'clock, and we were in there like all night. We were in there for like 7 hours. So we get to the first, we're showing Bryan all the spots that me and Bill had, all the stuff we had found and all the locations. And Bryan explains to us about the Nookashooks and the Karens and all that other stuff. And we get over to the three crystal stones. And I said, yep, this is going to be our first location. We'll set up a couple locations and we'll work our way back to the car. And we get there, and, you know, it's daylight hours. And Bryan, you want to pick it up from there?
Yeah, on the way in, as we were walking in, I'm fairly good with the woods. I've been in the woods many, many times growing up. I kept seeing something out of the corner of my eye, kind of like paralleling us in the woods. And you, when I would look at it, it looked like a leg for the most part, initially brown. And I just get a little glimpse of it, and then it would go behind a tree and it would disappear, which I found a little bit interesting. But we get up to the, you know, this is happening as we're walking deeper into the woods to the point where we have the three crystal balls that are there. Everybody sets up their camp. And then Al comes out with a parabolic mic initially. And we start scanning the area and just doing a general survey. And one of the things that Bill even mentioned it right off the bat, is it is unnaturally quiet at this place.
Oh, God, yeah.
Well, no birds, no quiet. Nothing. And it's just silence.
Lack of anything.
There's nothing. They have these ducks that are on the lake, which is really bizarre. They're just ducks, but they may just fly in and come out. But there's nothing else. There's no crickets. There's no birds. There's nothing. In the distance, you'll hear dogs or a little gunfire, because I think there's a shooting range a couple miles away from there.
That's strange, all by itself.
Yeah, usually, like when you get into something. Any type of wilderness, you'll hear something, especially near water. You'll hear a frog, you'll hear cricket. It wasn't that cold yet. So we're all doing our little survey. We're doing tests. We're testing for EMF. Al starts taking out the, I think initially we did the parabolic mic. Sorry about that. And he's looking around while I'm trying to broadcast a little bit on on a couple different sites off the cell phone, just giving people an idea of what's going on, where we are.
Right.
And Al just picks up. He hears tree knocks, if that's correct. I forgot it was tree knocks, and then it sounded like maybe a rock knock. And then he starts picking up this beeping sound.
Sound like a Geiger? Is that the Geiger counter stuff I was reading about?
It's there's a video on the evidence page there, and you'll hear it. It's actually a long video, but he starts, you know, picking up the sound, and as he points to the ground and he starts lifting it up higher up to the tree area, it gets louder. So everybody's trying to figure it out. My theory, and I went off on a different tangent, is if you consider the fact that there was a nuclear accident there 30, 40 years ago, roughly. By the time where we were, it could have been either a microwave transmission, military microwave that they do have in the area. It was a military installation transmitting. It could have been a craft above your head that we couldn't see. Or another thing is you're maybe picking up some residuals from radiation or whatever they caught. And when that tree 40 years ago, if you were there, it would be lower to the ground.
Yeah, the radiation theory is more of what I would go toward.
Yeah, so that's where I was, but it was still very perplexing. And then I will probably go into it right now. We started doing this thing with the skulls. I have a crystal skull, and Al has a rose quartz. Al,
yeah, rose quartz, yeah,
yeah.
And Al started. You want to go into the experiment? So as we started getting darker.
All right. Well, before we get there, my right ear is ringing all day, right? And I'm thinking, oh man, every time my right ear rings, I usually have a visitation or something to that effect. And I'm thinking, please God, don't let anything happen tonight, because the last thing I want is for these guys to get abducted as a cause of me. But in the other side of my brain, I'm thinking, you know, please let something happen so we don't spend 7 hours in the wood and come back with nothing, right? I'm thinking, I hope we catch something, you know? So now we get to this area, and for, like Bryan said, we're listening with the parabolic mic, and these dogs, someone's got a kennel, dogs are going crazy, they're barking at the moon, and there's coyotes on the other side of the lake, and they're howling and everything. So the first thing I do is I break out the compass, and I put it on the quartz crystals to read the pyramid quartz crystals, see if there's any energy, and its compass isn't moving, it's just pointing, you know, true north or whatever. Then I hit it with the thermal imager to see if I could see if there's any heat coming off it, and it was so cold that Bryan actually had to put his laser pointer on it so I could see it in the thermal imager, because I couldn't see it. And then I walked over with dowsing rods.
What time of year was this?
October. It was Halloween.
October 31st. Yeah, okay, I missed that.
And I walked over with the dowsing rods, and we didn't get anything we tried, we weren't getting any luck with. So I said, okay, now, you know, it's getting dark. I said, let's try, you know, let's let it get dark and we'll see what happens. So now it's a little dark. So we break out. Brian's got a clear quartz crystal. I got the rose quartz. His is supposed to be a transmitter. Mine is supposed to be a receiver. I said, let's put them on these stones and, you know, let's amp up the energy in the woods. And I break out my Tibetan singing bowl, and I'm hitting the singing bowl, and it's just the vibration and the frequency is just out there in the woods. It's just filling the woods with vibration and energy, and the whole atmosphere of the place changed. Okay?
Yeah.
I mean, you could just feel the energy ramp up. So at this point, I go back to doing my... We take photographs because we wanted to see if we can catch like any light anomalies jumping from one skull to the other, but we didn't get lucky. We didn't catch anything like that. Okay. So then I break out the compass again, and I go over. Now the compass is spinning like a top, man. It's just spinning. And I said, okay. And I get the dowsing rods, and I'm walking over. And every time I go near them, the dowsing rods are crossing. And it's a funny feeling if you ever have dowsing rods in your hands and feel the energy of them moving by themselves.
Yeah, it makes your hands tingle.
Yeah, I've never felt them before. It was the first time I ever used them there that they actually worked. Okay, so it was blowing my mind just to see how these things work. Then I hit it with the thermal imager again. Now these stones are lit up; they're white hot, white hot. And I go, Brian, touch them because they're white hot on thermal imager. Let's see if they're hot to the touch. And, but they were ice cold to the touch. So Brian says, let's call Cindy and we'll see what happens. So we call Cindy on the phone because Cindy is down south. She's not with us. And we put the phone on the quartz crystal and we try to ask her questions. And Cindy, you want to take it from here?
Well, first, you know, he was supposed to give me some warning and everything about when they got there and got ready. But when I was talking to him on the phone, he wasn't making a lot of sense. I kept saying, Al, where are you? Or whatever. But what began to happen, I started having this intense vibration that was coming up from the ground through my body out the top of my head. I've been doing this since I was 15. I have never, ever felt anything like this. My body, I felt like it was actually coming out of my body. It was so intense that I could not speak. So I finally got out to Al, like this, move away.
Move the phone. She's like, move the phone.
Yes. Move away, because I really believe I would have passed out unconscious if he had not moved away from this area. The energy was so intense at this place, it was weeks later before I was back to normal.
Right.
I mean, I have ever felt nothing like this. Usually energy flows, it doesn't vibrate.
Yeah. So you are connected to Al, and that is why you're feeling this energy and receiving the energy?
Well, yes. Actually, when he has the phone, I can feel the energy at the site also.
Okay.
Yes, without even through Al.
Okay.
Because I'm able to read sites or locations like that I'm there. No, this energy, I was feeling myself coming through my body, not through Al. I was connected to these skulls and this, and I could actually see them. And I had drawn a picture a week before. I could actually see this energy, this white hot energy.
So you are clairvoyant and you are a Reiki master?
No.
No, no. No, the other Cindy, our editor, is a Reiki master.
Oh, okay.
We have two Cindys.
Oh, that's confusing. Okay, because I knew that you were clairvoyant, and that's why you can see what's going on.
And I'm an empath.
Empathic. Well, that's basically the same thing.
Yeah.
Me, at least.
So I can read any type of energies. I can tell the difference in the energy that comes from a tree. From grass, I can actually tell the different
energies. Yeah, because it's all different vibrations.
Yes. And I know when there's something very strange going on, because everything on the planet Earth has a similar type of energy or vibration.
Right.
What happens when you have a paranormal experience, to me, the first thing happens is the energy is alien. Not alien like an ET, it's foreign to this planet. So this energy, whether it be a ghost or you see a crypto animal or whatever, this high strangeness, I can immediately feel the energy is not right. It doesn't fit in with everything else.
So are you saying that the energy is more of from a different dimension?
Well, I don't really know about, I don't have, all the answers. I don't really know if it's a different dimension, or it could be just a different vibration. There's even thoughts that different colors have different vibrations and things.
Well, yeah, that's why you see different colors and light, because the vibration is a little bit different.
So, it could be coming from all of those things. It's the energy is not bad energy, okay?
Okay.
It's just different energy than the energy that I feel around the earth and around all the people here.
Right.
So that alerts me to this something different is happening. That there is some type of high strangeness going on, and that is really the best word.
High strangeness. Okay.
One of the interesting things that was happening is that she's on the phone, and to us, she sounded like she had Bell's palsy, like she couldn't talk. It was really bizarre, but as we moved her away from that zone, and we moved maybe 25 feet away from there, she started to recover, and like, wow, I feel better. Did you, you know, I think she asked if we moved or we told her we were moving. I don't recall that, but she's like, wow, that was really powerful. And apparently, you know, this whatever the energy was that we stirred up at those rocks was strong enough to affect people well out of state. it was pretty intense, and it's funny. Not only was Cindy feeling this in where she is, but I mean, you just felt this pressure building around you in the dark. It wasn't because of the light or people were nervous about the darkness.
Did it feel like it felt when you're underneath power lines?
For me, no. It felt like, pardon the expression, you know, the blank's going to hit the fan any minute now.
Yeah.
And that's what it felt like, and you can just feel it. Everything, you know, your body starts getting a little more tense. You just you're anticipating, you're waiting, because not only was this happening, you know, you keep hearing these tree knocks, you hear a rock knock, you hear things creeping in the, like, you know, a little bit in the woods. You hear walking, and it's a very intense feeling. It's kind of hard to actually describe. It's not like the power lines. We have a couple places by me where there's energy given off, electricity. Yeah. And I know exactly what you're kind of leading up to, but right. This was a different type of like power.
So it was more. Well, I don't intense. Know how to describe
it. It was intense,
kind of
man. It was intense. That's how you describe it. It was intense. So the energy really amps up at this point, and it's pretty dark, and we're all hanging out. You know, we all have 18-inch machetes on us. We all carry 10-inch survival knives. Everybody's got 2 cans of pepper spray on them because we are in the woods, and there are big animals in the woods. You know, we got mountain lions and black bears and packs of coyotes.
Right.
So, you know, we didn't go in, you know, unarmed. We were not stupid. And we got our headlamps on, and, you know, we got glow sticks for around campfire because we don't want to light a fire. We don't want to let anybody know we're there, you know.
Right.
We don't want to give away our position if there's other people in the woods doing the same thing we're doing. And all so I take out the parabolic mic, and, man, I hear something walking towards us from a good distance away, but it's big and it's heavy. And I let Bill listen to it, and I let Bryan listen to it. And I say, man, I think there's some dude coming our way in the swamp. And Bryan and Bill say, Al, that's not a dude, man. That's way too big, way too heavy. And I'm thinking, no, it's a dude. And you got to understand, the energy in this place was affecting all of us. Because the whole time Cindy was telling us, you guys sound strange. We were telling her, no, it's not us. It's you who sound strange.
Did it, like, make you feel drunk?
Not drunk, just strange, man. It's hard to explain it. The energy was intense.
I got to pine in because, you know what? It was weird. Now, I'm looking at this from a different perspective. These guys, you know, this is what they do. And I'm pretty much an observer there. I'm just along pretty much for the ride.
Right.
I'm there watching all these things going on. And I got to tell you, Arizona, when I heard that sound, that woot, whatever it was, I was saying to myself, no, this just can't be. I you know, it. You see and hear about this stuff. And, you know, you wonder what it would be like. And then now you're there. You're actually hearing what a lot of people talk about, or the lore of it. And I'm hearing it, and I'm looking at them, and I'm like, guys, what the hell? I hate to say it like that, but what the heck is that? I mean, it went on 3, 4, whatever times it was, and it was moving from one location, then it would be in another location. The dogs were going crazy in the distance. I mean, all the things that were going on. And as far as what they're saying with the energy, one minute you felt comfortable, the next minute, uneasy.
Well, Bill, what is it exactly that got you, like, really amped up and up there and freaky? And was it when you started checking out the branches that were so high up that nobody could reach them and they're just snapped off?
Again, it was everything. You see, that's the thing. It was too coincidental. It's one thing when you see one thing going on and, you know, something else, but it was just the combination of all the elements. It was too many coincidences going on. Branches being broken, fresh. And I looked for evidence of possible limbs that have come from above that could have crashed on these limbs and caused them to break like this. Some of these branches were twisted. Some of them were young, saplings. I mean, then on top of that, he's telling me, and I looked it up, about a story. Remember where he told you about that footprint by the lake?
Yeah.
There was a Bigfoot sighting there documented. I think it was in 2007. So all these things are coming together. And then with the lack of animal life, no bugs. And this is the middle of the fall where you have all the acorns all over the place. There's an abundance of food supply. Yet you don't see no squirrels. Yeah. You see nothing. And nothing at all. Devoid of life.
And usually when Bigfoot shows up, everybody splits.
Hey, let me tell you. These dogs and these were barking all night long because of that damn full moon. And so were the coyotes. Yep. But we were sitting there, Arizona. We're sitting there, and we hear this thing coming up to us. And I don't know, for some reason, I was insisting it was a dude. And everybody else was like, Al, it's not a dude. And we're listening, and we hear this rock knock. Boom, boom. Like these two rocks get knocked together. Yep. And I'm like, holy crap, right? So then we hear these three whoops. Whoop. Whoop. We're 30 feet up on a ridge line, okay? Yeah. And these whoops are coming from below us in a swamp. And the ground that we're standing on is vibrating.
So do you think Bigfoot was telling other Bigfoot
What Bryan thinks.
Do you think it was a warning to get the hell out of there because they didn't want you there anymore?
Basically, when it started happening, right? So you hear things walking up towards you. There's something coming at you. And it's a heavy sound. It's kind of like, if you ever been near a circus with your kids or grandkids?
Yeah.
When an elephant walks, you can feel it. There's a presence there. So you hear this walking up and creeping, and you're paying attention to that. And then across the lake, maybe a couple hundred feet across the lake, you hear a tree knock. Mm-hmm. And then the next thing you know, you hear the whoop, whoop, whoop. And my opinion was, this thing was telling whatever it was in the woods, nope, there's three of them, stay where you are. And those whoops were telling the other entities or whatever it was that was there, don't come any further, there's three of them there.
That would make sense with that explanation. The whoop was the count of how many of you.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah.
Bryan thought that one that was near us was the scout.
Yeah, you know.
And you know what was funny? Arizona, we're all sitting there, and this is about 8 o'clock, 8:30-ish. It's dark, completely pitch black, because we're in the middle of the woods, and we have the glow sticks on the ground. And Bryan is at the end, Al is in the middle, and I'm on the other end.
Yeah.
And a big rock goes right by Bryan from behind him, and we're looking at you like, what the heck just happened?
This was not just a big rock, but prior to this taking place, after the whoops, this thing took off for a bit. I mean, it was far. It was like a mile out. And there's no way. Farther?
Yeah, it was at least the other end of the lake, 2 miles away. Absolutely.
There is absolutely no way you can do it. It was pitch black. You're in a swamp without hearing any other noise. This thing went from point A to point B in a matter of like seconds.
Yep. Seconds. And, Arizona seconds.
I mean, like, super duper fast, and we're all standing up at this point, and we're facing that location, that area. It's pitch black, and I think all of us had something, you know, like the machetes. You know, mine was at least 3/4 out of the sheath, and I'm like, okay, you know, I can't run into this water because it's radiated. So I got one shot at this. You know, this is what's going to happen, and my wife is going to kill me when I get home.
Well, you could have.
Arizona. After we heard those three whoops, we all jumped over this stone wall. There was like a 3-foot stone wall behind us that we were using to put our backs towards.
Yeah, I saw that in video there.
And we all jumped over that wall. Because I was the first one to go over that wall because I wanted to see what was in that swamp. I wanted to see if it was another person, if it was another person, if they had a flashlight, a headlamp, or whatever. And we all jumped over that wall, and we looked down into that swamp. And, man, what was ever in there did not have a flashlight or a headlamp, and it's dangerous. These rocks are dangerous. I mean, I don't know how you could walk around in the pitch black without any kind of light to see where you're going.
Well, you gotta have good eyes, man.
then we all go back and we sit down and we hunker down and we're sitting there. And like I said, stone comes thrown over Brian's head, and all night long we're hearing shit creeping up on us, like things like Native Americans when they creep up on a people to kill them and everything. We hear this creeping up on us all night, and we're looking with the night vision goggles. I mean, the night vision cameras. There's nothing in the light spectrum in the night vision. We can't see it. We break out the thermal images. We hear creeping all around us. We put the thermal imager on it. We can't see it. We can't see it in either one of these spectrums of light. We can't see it with our own eyes, but it was all around us. There was movement all around us at all. And Cindy said, "Oh, you're gonna see this. You're gonna see that. This place is like a portal where everything comes in and out of. And this is like the perfect storm being there on this night." And she goes, "You guys are just gonna have. You're gonna see." And I never believe her when she says you're gonna see this, that, the other thing. You know,
he never does.
No, I never do. Yeah, and she'll tell you I don't.
He seems like the type that don't believe.
No, we'll just cross that bridge when we get to it, and we'll see what happens. And man, she's always right. So we hunkered down there for a little while, and whatever, we're just sitting there, and all of a sudden we hear this sounds like a mountain lion running up the ridge line. It's coming, man. This thing is coming. Something is coming up the ridge. It's coming and it's coming. It's getting closer.
Look at Bill, actually.
It's getting louder. Bill is the one guy closest to the wall with his back to it. So we all jump up and we pull our knives out. Bill jumps up and he starts to run. And I grab him. I spin him around. I say, "Don't run. Face it. Face whatever comes over that wall. Face it." And he's like, "Okay." And we're waiting for this thing to come over this wall. Because I would have swore on a stack of Bibles it was a mountain lion coming over that ridge. And it was going to jump
or a bear.
Jump over that wall and right on top of one of us. Gets to that wall. You hear the sound coming. It gets to that wall, and then it's gone. Nothing ever comes over that wall. And the only thing I could attribute it to is it was a bluff charge. And bears do them. And Sasquatch is doomed to try to drive people away
from
places they don't want them to be. But we held our ground and we didn't move. And after it couldn't get us to leave, it gave up and it left.
It's like the hell with these guys.
It seems to me that if you have, sorry, Bill, go ahead.
No, I'm sorry, but the thing that was weird about that was you hear it coming and it was close. I mean, literally, it was feet away, but you did not hear it withdraw. You did not hear it leave as it came. It just was gone. You would hear it leave. You got to remember, this is the fall. This is Halloween. Yeah. Lots of foliage, leaves on the ground.
Leaf litter all over the ground.
Well, you would have heard it retreat. Nothing.
It seems to me that had you ran, it would have ended up very badly.
I'll tell you one thing. I didn't want my back on because I was sitting on the end. And like he said, it was coming like it was coming to me. So I got up and Al grabbed me by my waist and spun me around because I didn't want to have my back to whatever the hell was coming up right behind me. And I had this big, powerful flashlight. And I'm telling you, I had a powerful flashlight. This thing was powerful.
Yeah,
this thing you could see. And earlier, this is another thing on that video that I was recording. Al had a parabolic mic. And this is another one of those weird things that happened earlier that night. It was you could hear the tree knock on the video as Al is holding the parabolic mic. You can hear it in the video in the distance. It's just crazy. And then tell Bryan and Al, discuss about the sound that the parabolic mic was picking up.
Oh, that Morse code thing. Yeah, it was crazy. Yeah, to me, it sounded like a Morse code coming out of the sky. Yeah, you know. And Bryan said, "Oh, it could be the radiation in the trees." And I said, "Or it could be a craft above us that we can't see monitoring us, because you know I got this ringing in my ear and I'm thinking, you know, maybe we're going to get some visitors tonight, you know."
Yeah, I mean, so you also have to consider, like, you know, I mean, I'm trying to think a little bit more rational, try to put things in perspective, and I'm thinking military site, military material, maybe they're broadcasting. I always had this vision of maybe these guys are stuck underground for 40 years and they're trying to broadcast, "Hey, we're still alive down here, but no one's going to go get them."
Oh, wow.
So there's all these different things playing around in your head what it could be. But it was very, very strange.
Yeah. So I saw a video of orbs. When did this take place?
Okay. So after everything calms down at the first location with the three crystal stones after the bluff charge, and we held our ground, and they threw rocks, and we wouldn't leave, and we just hung tight. Everything mellowed out after about an hour. I said, okay, you know what, guys? I think whatever was here, because now you could feel the energy change again. That intensity, that energy that was in the air after the Tibetan singing bowl ramped everything up. And I thought whatever came over to see us was drawn over by that singing bowl. I think that whatever the frequency or vibration it put out, because right after we did that bowl, that thing came to us to see who the hell was over there. And everything just mellowed out, like the energy just left the room, boom, and said, so I said, let's pack it up and let's move over to our second location. We had scouted out really three locations, and we were going to hit the closer ones to the cars on the way out. And everybody says, okay, so we packed up all our gear, and we had a ton of gear with us, and we're walking, you know, towards the second location, heading due north to the lake. We get to the furthest northern point of the lake, and we see this light in the sky, you know, and I'm looking at it, and I see this silver light. It's like a strobe light. It's going from west to east, and then all of a sudden it just stops, and it starts going south like it's headed towards the city, and then but it doesn't turn. It just goes south, and then it stops, and the next thing you know, the thing is making a beeline for us, and Bryan and Bill's like, what the hell is that? And
it was,
now this thing changing colors, you know what I mean?
It was very interesting. So, you know, when it's moving in the sky, we all notice it. You could not notice it because we're pretty familiar with like air traffic in the area, and this was totally out of sorts.
So it wasn't a drone and it wasn't an airplane.
Well, it's at a distance. It's at a pretty big distance, and we all said it like, "What's that?" And we kind of pointing at it, and the minute we said that, it stopped and it just headed right towards us.
Yeah.
And it's coming towards us, and I tell the guys, I say, listen, when it gets closer, shut off your headlamps, see what happens, you know? And we all shut off our headlamps as it gets to us, and it's hovering just above the treetops. It's making this low electrical hum kind of noise, but, you know, maybe when it was a little higher, we couldn't hear anything. It sounded like it wasn't making any noise at all. I guess maybe as it came down at a lower altitude, we could hear this low. And we're all looking at it. We shut off our headlamps. As soon as we shut off our headlamps, it hits us with a floodlight. Like it's trying to get a better look at us. But the floodlight isn't coming down to the ground. It's just staying like in the trees. And because I looked down to make sure I wasn't standing in any light. You know what I mean? I don't want to get beamed up anywhere. And I immediately turned to Bill and I said, give me a time check. And he says, it's 9:15. I said, okay. So Brian's streaming live on Twitter. He's filming the whole thing. You know, good thing he had live stream going at the time.
There's a question I have.
All our gear was packed away because we were moving from one location to the other.
There's
you know?
A question I have. How the hell do you stream live on Twitter?
There's a program called Periscope.tv. You can link it up on your cell phone and you can just stream live anywhere. Yeah.
Okay, well, go ahead now. I'm sorry.
Well, it's funny. While this is all going on, I remember, you know, I had my new camera with me. It's actually good for taking night shots. And I said, I pulled it out of my pocket because I put it purposely by the breast pocket for easy access. If something happened, I don't want to be that guy that never had the camera on him.
Right.
And I pulled this out, and you can see in the video that's on the evidence page. But I'm filming this right now. I'm filming it right now. Unfortunately, it is a it's a compact kind of like digital camera. It's not the greatest lens, but I literally had it going the minute it happened. I just started. I went as soon as it started coming at us. I pulled that camera out. I was videotaping as much as I could. It was pretty interesting experience right there.
Yeah, those orbs that I saw in the video, those were pretty fascinating. And I understand that Cindy, you think that these orbs were something.
Yes, you know, I had, when I could see this place in my mind, I kept seeing all these lights in the woods, and I told Al several times. I said, this place is full of light anomalies. It's full of them. And my impression that I got is these were actually, it sounds crazy, but these were actually creatures. And some of these creatures are like, what like, we would call like insects or butterflies.
Like
but
fairies?
These other creatures were basically alive.
Say, I mean, Cindy, they could say the word.
Like
Cindy.
Fairies?
Fairies. Yes. Yeah. Fairies. And I said, I told him, I said, this is crazy, but fairies keeps coming in my mind. That these are fairies.
Fairy lights are awesome.
Right. I mean, and it was very strange because I had never run across this before, the fairy lights. And I told Al, I said, you know, they're fairies. It's crazy. See, this place is like, you know, you hear people talking about the veil is thinner and you have all this very high strangeness to happen. This place is like that, but, you know, amped up by 20.
Well, fairies are guardians. And
yes.
Fairies and are guardians of dragons.
Guardian, over and over. And I told Al about that. I said, there are some guardians here. I said, I keep getting this in my mind. I kept writing it out. And I actually saw a line of a circle when Bill and Bryan and Al were in a circle. Yep. I saw a line of people and creatures, including a Bigfoot creature, that were surrounding them in a bigger circle, and they were watching, and they were absolutely no silence. A stern look on these people, because there were people there too, space. And I kept getting, like I said, guardian. And I'd also told Al, how many times did I tell you about the Bigfoot that you were going to run into out there?
Yeah, you said that we were definitely going to run into a Bigfoot. You said leprechauns, yes. And gnomes, and
I mean, there was everything out there.
Everything.
Guys.
Now, were you guys still in like the alternate world or a different world?
At this point, Arizona, we get to the second location, and we make this circle that Cindy is talking about.
And okay? And not just that, it was a circle. The area itself was a circle.
Yeah, the area itself was a circle. And we get into the circle, and it's like a semi-campsite just off the Appalachian Trail. People are coming off the trail. They would have to come right out to where we're sitting. And it was a nice, clear area because there was a meteor shower going at night, so Bill wanted to film the meteor shower for his Skywatch YouTube page, and we're sitting in there, and the whole time we're there, Bryan said, no, first we call Cindy again, and she tells us about all these creatures we're going to see, the gnomes, the leprechauns, the fairies, and all this stuff, and we're like, yeah, okay, yeah. We're going to see all this shit, right? Yeah.
Okay. She was saying that they're literally watching us right now, and yep, and yeah. Actually, I'm facing Al. Al's facing me more and looking over my shoulder towards the lake. So I have a view of the woods, and I'm catching these things like it's in the dark within the dark moving, and I'm seeing these things going on, and I'm like, there's something moving over there. So it's not like your eyes playing tricks. There's movement while this is happening.
I understand? That's, yeah.
And Bryan is seeing these 2-foot white little creatures running around in the woods. In the meantime, I'm looking over Brian's shoulder, and I'm seeing these 12-foot shadow figures jumping from tree to tree. And I'm saying, any of you guys seen this? And now I'm breaking out my camera, and I'm taking photographs with the flash on, with the flash off, to see if I can catch these giant dark figures. And Bill is filming the meteor shower, and Bryan says, hey, Bill, why don't you film those trees? Because I keep seeing these white little creatures. So Bill says, okay. So I said, Bill, I'll hold the monitor. You work the camera. So Bill's standing over my shoulder. I'm sitting down, and I'm holding the monitor. And Bill is filming. Bill, get it. Take it from here.
Well, I was using the night vision camera, and that, you know, that can pick up all the objects that we wouldn't normally see with the eyes, you know, in the darkness. And all of a sudden, it looked like 2 shadowy things. That's all I can describe it, because I don't know what the heck it was. Yeah,
but it was white shadows, Bill.
It was.
White shadows.
Yeah, I would say it was entities. I'll leave it at that, because I really cannot say what the heck it was. All I know is it jumped, 2 of them, one right after another. Yep. And I said, Al, did you see that? And Al said, Bill, I'm looking at the monitor. I've seen it. And unfortunately, this really got me upset.
And we were really excited because we both seen it at the same time. Bill through the viewfinder of the camera, and me at the monitor,
yes.
holding the monitor that was attached to the camera in my hand. So we was like, okay, we got this, man. We got this on film. How cool was that? Oh,
I was upset when I got home and I found out there was nothing. And this is the weird part, too. It showed it was recording. it did show it was recording on the device. When I got home, there was nothing. It was
wasn't even an artifact on there. Normally in digital or anything computer related, you'll get some kind of like a trash file.
Yeah.
This had nothing. And I was looking at that monitor. He was filming. It said like 20, either 24 or 45 minutes or something. I'm like, yep. This is awesome. We got this proof. This is going to be great.
Yep.
Nothing.
There was absolutely nothing. There wasn't any static or nothing.
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 Zero.
Damn.
Not even the whatchamacallit,
SD card.
Nothing. That's what there was. It was a mini SD card, and there was nothing on it. Zero.
Not even the media shower.
I have an explanation for some of this. I'm wondering if Cindy will agree with me. It sounds like you guys stepped in and out of the moment several different times.
Well, it's funny you bring that up.
Arizona,
it's funny you're saying that. When we were at the first location, I would take my camera. I take 360s, photos because it takes really nice shots. You'll see on the evidence page, and I caught, I think, a blue mist.
Yeah.
Or a misty thing. No, a red fog or something like that there. When we got to the last location and all this stuff was taking place and Al seeing these anomalies are behind me, I didn't want to get up to take it, so I literally held it in my hand and I started taking pictures. And we got the other mist, like this whitish blue mist. Yep. And also, well, we actually were on the phone with Cindy, we heard people talking as if they were going to come around the corner. Yep. And like, we don't want to scare them. There's three guys in the woods. We got knives on us. You know, if someone comes around the corner, that may freak people out. So,
let me explain it like this. We're sitting there in the woods. We just finished talking to Cindy. Again, another time check. It's 9:30. Okay. All this stuff is going down. The light anomalies. We're seeing light anomalies deep in the woods. I'm taking pictures. Bryan and I have two different cameras. We both captured the blue mist. Bryan got the red fog. Now we hear, it's not just people coming through the woods. It's a family. It's a young boy, a young girl, a mother and father. And they're laughing and they're joking and they're laughing and they're walking through the woods. And they're coming right at us. And I'm like, holy crap. Who would bring their family walking on the Appalachian Trail at night on Halloween? That's insane. So I turned to the guys and I said, now we're sitting there in the dark, you know? So put your headlamps on. This way, when these people come out, we don't scare them because we're sitting there, all weaponed up and everything, you know? And we wait and we hear them coming and they're coming and they're coming. And we're just waiting for them to step out of off the trail and onto the campsite. And no one ever comes out. No one ever comes out. It just ends. It just disappears like there's nobody there.
Wow, man.
That was creepy. It was weird.
I'd have
it
to say what you're smoking, but I know better. I know you weren't.
Well, you know, Al, if you remember, I had told you that you were going to hear people's voices and all that same thing. Because I could hear them when I was reading the site. I could hear people's voices.
Yeah.
So I wanted to make sure, remember I told you, I said, I think you should check and make sure there's no real people around there, out playing prank or whatever on Halloween, because right. I kept hearing these people also. And Arizona, to your question earlier, yes, I agree with you.
Okay, good, yeah. good. Didn't you say something about how that was a family? Us guys, we talked before the show yesterday, and I talked to Cindy today and stuff. But didn't you say something about how the family you just talked about was went to the park the next day?
Yeah, yes. we were talking to Cindy about this, and she mentioned that there was like a time shift, yeah. Or a rip, or we a portal. And
that's why I said the moment, yeah.
Well, yeah. Well, what was interesting is after that moment, after the people were talking, we kind of looked like, what time is it? And we looked and we got the, what was it, 11:30 at that point?
11:30 at that point, yeah.
So it was, and we were like, there's no way because it was just 9:30.
Yeah, so we just talked. I'm arguing with Phil when he's telling me it's 11:30. I says it's impossible. We just talked to Cindy a half hour ago. It can't be any later than 10. And he's like, Al, it's 11:30. And I'm like, where did those 2 hours go? Where did they go? And I'm talking to Cindy the next day, and she says the family you heard in the park they were actually going to be there the following day. And the reason why you got the blue mist and the red fog and all that other stuff is because you guys were in a time-space continuum or something to that effect, a different dimension.
Yeah, the moment. You were in the moment. The moment is what exists between the two worlds.
Yeah.
It sounds really bizarre, you guys. I know this sounds, but this stuff is actually real. I mean, you know, this stuff does happen. There's a lot of things that goes on in this world that people don't know about or refuse to acknowledge.
And I know,
and we are not crazy, any of us.
Oh, I am.
Yeah, I know how it may sound like you are leprechauns and fairies, but I got to tell you, when I was using my night vision camera, in the trees, now remember, there's no leaves. The foliage, they're all down. I mean, it's all on the ground.
Right.
I was seeing multiple clusters of orb-looking objects in the trees. Up in the trees, there was an abundant amount of orbs.
You got pictures of those orbs. You got pictures, right? I've seen them.
Yeah. I don't know if I've got them. I think they have them. They took them. But I've seen this with my... I was looking at this through my night vision, and it just looked like the whole night vision camera was sparkling with all these orbs in the trees. And like I said, the only thing that could pick that up, it would be if there were leaves there, and you would be able to see the leaves in the with that close up with the night camera.
Right.
Night vision.
It's interesting about orbs. I'm not a really big believer in orbs because most of the time you're kicking up dirt and you're getting a little flash, you know, back. But this was different. These are have weight
Ooh,
to it,
shit.
Have mass.
Ooh. Scott, sorry about that, guys. Thunder just stuck in my house.
That's all right.
And well, see, that's the aliens coming back now.
Yeah, they're coming for you.
Like, we're getting blue dots. We're getting red dots. You're getting them in the distance and up close. There's no way. I mean, these were legit, in my opinion, legitimate orbs. And when we got the information back from Cindy about the time shift, the first thing that came in my mind was, I think it's called The Final Conflict. It's a movie way back when. And in that movie, it's recreation pretty much of the Philadelphia experiment, where they try to do this, basically. And they may have caught a rip in space, and some of the soldiers were on these ships were caught between decks. I mean, it was a horrifying experiment. This is what you can read about.
Yeah, I know about that.
So, I mean, the plausibility of us, that missing time being a rip in space or traveling or moving... It very well could happen. This place was very, very strange. Amazingly strange.
Yeah, so we're still sitting there, and we're trying to figure this out, where the 2 hours went. And at this point, I see these two light anomalies on the other side of the lake. And I'm saying, you know, there's no way we can go to that side of the lake. It's like 2 miles away. So I said to Bryan, you hit the one on the right with your green laser. I'll hit the one on the left with my red laser. And I told Bill, I said, when we hit him with the lasers, you hit him with this. He had like this 5,000 lumen flashlight that just lit up the woods like it looked, you know, like an alien light, right?
Right.
So I says, okay, on three, everybody hits him. So wow. Me and Bryan, we hit these two little white anomalies, which I would consider, Cindy would consider being the fairies, right? We hit him with the lasers. As soon as we hit him with our lasers, they went off. Bill hits that whole area with this giant flashlight. I mean, you could have seen, you know, it was just lit up like daylight, and there's nothing there. There's nothing there. Where did these things go? You know, if it was a physical creature, you would have seen it in that flashlight. That flashlight was so bright, it was ridiculous.
It was like a car headlight on the brights?
Pretty much.
Yeah, but they were small. They were small, like little balls of light. But they were bright, man. I mean, they were, you know, considering we're out in the dark in the woods. You know, and these things are off in the woods. They're not like hovering over the lake where there's no trees or anything. It's in the woods. It's in the shrubs. But they're bright. And, you know, and I had a feeling we were going to see them. And I heard stories about these things, and I, you know, people trying to chase these things down through the woods, and they can never catch them. And that's why I told Bryan, I said, bring your laser, and I'll bring mine. And he's like, why? And I said, I'll tell you when we get there. Because I had a feeling, you know, if anything was going to be able to get them, it was going to be those lasers, you know, that could hit them. And we did. We hit them with the lasers. Don't know what we did to them. Couldn't see anything. We didn't know where they went. But it's just crazy how shit just disappeared. One minute it was there, and then the next minute it was gone. Like Bill said, the Bigfoot that was underneath us, it did rock knocks, tree knocks, and whoops. We never heard it walk away. But the next thing you know, we hear a tree knock two miles down at the other end of the lake. The same thing was ever bluff rushed us. You can hear this four-legged creature charging up on the leaf litter, coming at us. Gets to the stone wall, and it just stops. And there's nothing. Where'd it go? It didn't stop and then walk back down the hill. It just was gone. I mean, shit, just these people, this whole family that was coming through the park. I mean, Bill and I actually got up and walked on the Appalachian Trail a little bit to see if we could see him because he had that huge flashlight. There was nobody there. I mean, it was just the energy of this place was just off the charts, man. This place was just insane.
It sounds insane to me. I kind of want to go, but then at the same time, after talking to Cindy today, I don't know that I want to go.
I either scare people or they think I'm crazy. So,
no, I don't think you're crazy at all.
Cindy always calls me like a week before we're about to go somewhere, and she'll say, "Where you guys going?" And I'll say, "Why?" And she'll say, "Because I've been having these dreams, or I've been seeing this, and I've been seeing that." And I don't tell her what we're going to do. You know, I just call her when we get there, and I just start laughing because she always knows what we're up to, you know? At least with me, we're connected somehow, you know what I mean?
Must have given out the vibe.
Right.
She always calls me. And it's funny because Bryan always says, "Has Cindy called you yet?" And I said, "Not yet, but it's coming soon," you know?
Yeah.
It's always good to get a little recon in before you go out there because you never know what you're going to get, or you can just be prepared for it. But, you know, with this place, after we left and we're heading out, what was really strange is the fact that as we got just past that lake spot on the road back home to the parking lot area, started seeing all these deer and all these different animals, and it was just a totally different world, a totally different field. Like, these animals should have been where we were.
Right,
and so they weren't.
So you only went to two of the locations that you scouted out?
Right, because we were headed towards the third location where all the campers and the hikers see the Bigfoots, okay? And that was my game plan, to be there for 12. And now you got to remember, we've been in the woods for 7 hours, and this energy in this place has really got us burnt out. We're a little confused. We don't know what happened. We're missing 2 hours. But we're getting to this third location right around 11:45, and this is when I wanted to get there, around 12 o'clock. And then I realized, oh, shit, tonight's the night. We got to turn the clocks back an hour. Now, at the time, I'm thinking, because nobody is thinking straight, that we have to turn it back at 12, and nobody really wants to sit at this location for another hour. You know what I mean? So we choose to pack it up and skip the third location, and we start hiking out. And the craziest thing is, we're talking, and we're walking out of the woods, and we're talking, and everybody's saying, "Wow, what a shitty night, nothing happened, you know, we didn't catch anything," and, you know, nobody, it was like we didn't, like, nothing happened, like, we didn't experience anything. Meanwhile, you know, all this stuff happened, everything we could possibly have dreamed of and more went down, and we're walking out thinking, what a crappy night, nothing happened. And the game plan was, when we got back to the cars, to head to the diner, grab a cup of coffee and a bite to eat, and discuss the night. We were all so strung out that we were just... And the funny thing is, Cindy kept telling me, "I see a female's energy. I see a female's energy. There's going to be a female there." And I'm telling her, there's no females coming with us. I doubt very much we're going to run into any chicks in the woods on Halloween. You know, there's no females. So on the way out, we got to pass the ranger station, and you can't get past the ranger station. It's got dogs, and they're always gonna catch you. So as we're walking out, and Bill says, "Oh, shut the headlights off, our headlamps." I go, "No, leave them on, because we're leaving the lake anyway." You know what I mean? What are they gonna do? We're on our way out. So we're walking out, and all of a sudden, the dogs go crazy, and the ranger comes out of the house, and he starts to question us, and it's a chick. And I turn to these guys and I say, "This must be the chick that Cindy's talking about, because all night long she keeps talking about she's feeling a woman's energy at this place." And, you know, who thought that the ranger was going to be abroad? You know what I mean? Not me.
Right.
That was the last thing on my mind. So then anyway, we're supposed to jump in our cars and go to the diner, but we're all so whacked out from the energy of this place. We jump in our cars and everybody goes in different directions. And then the next day, Bryan calls me and he says, did you wake up with any injuries? And I'm like, what are you talking about? He says, I woke up with a bump on my head. And I go, you know what? I woke up with a fat lip. I feel like there's something implanted in my bottom lip. Like there's something really hard in the back of my lip. So he goes, call Bill. So we call Bill and I said, Bill, did you wake up with any injuries? And he says, yeah. He says, I got like a bump on my back and I don't know where it came from. So now we call Cindy and she said, yeah, she woke up with a rash on her arm. Like everybody's got some kind of injury. Nobody went down that night. Nobody knows where these injuries came from.
Well,
it just appeared.
You've got these bumps. Are they implants? Did you guys get abducted during that 2 hours of lost time?
That's a good question. I woke up and there was like this metallic-y taste in the back of my mouth. And my phlegm for some reason was blue.
Ew.
Which was really
bizarre.
You ate
Smurfs. That's what you did. You ate Smurfs.
I think Papa Smurf was there that night. But that was really weird. I woke up and I'm like, okay, that's when I called Al, and Al had this experience. I think Bill, I don't know if Bill was having something with night terror or something thereafter. But another thing that happened to me a little bit later on is I'm getting, you know, I'm trying to go out during the day on the next day, and my wife goes, what happened? And I look down, and like, what are you talking about? And on my stomach and my chest are two black and blue marks. And nothing hit me whatsoever. I didn't walk into anything whatsoever. I'm like, I have no idea how this
got. You didn't get hit by any of the rocks that Bigfoot threw at you?
No, that wasn't a rock. That was like a boulder. That was had some serious
boulder.
He was not happy. He was like, oh, these guys aren't leaving. I'm going to throw this at them. So, but no, it was pretty intense that we kind of kept feeling really strange afterwards, like a little disoriented. You know, things just weren't back. It was like, whatever happened out there seemed to be affecting us for the couple of days thereafter.
I was loopy for 3 days. There's no doubt. Maybe even longer. And I think, Bill, isn't like right after that is when you started having your night terrors again?
Yeah, and that's the whole thing. I told you guys what happened to me a few weeks ago. And I can't make out. I mean, I never had. I've always had these dreams where they're recurring, they're vivid, and it's like something coming through my house. But it escalated. A few weeks ago, I told you about this, Al, and I think Lorraine, that's in chat right now, I had a dream of, I will just call it a gray, with long spindly fingers coming over me in my bed, and I'm going to tell exactly the way it is. I tried to bite its finger off as it was coming up to me, and it scratched me or bit me, and I woke up with 3 scratches on my leg, and I took a picture of it and I showed it to them. So, I mean, it's just odd the way things have escalated since that happened. And another thing, too, is when we were leaving Nuclear Lake that night, again, we mentioned about how there was a lack of animal life, devoid of any kind of life.
Yeah.
As soon as we hit the path, we see a lot of deer, other type of animals. I mean, it was it's as soon as we left the lake area, that's when you started to see all the animals again. And it seemed they were avoiding the area. You know, that's what struck me odd, is the way the animals were reacting and acting.
So did the animals stay on the outside?
Yes.
Of the stone wall is what you're telling me?
They were on the path on the way back to where going back to where the vehicles were parked to the road, where we were walking back to the main road. They were all there, but they wouldn't go near the lake. Everything was staying away from the lake area.
Yeah, a good half mile away from the lake.
At least, yes.
Good half mile. It was crazy because all these packs of deer or herds of deer and packs of coyote are all hanging out by the main road. You know, it's like a main truck route, Route 55. You got semis going up and down at 100 miles an hour. It's 4-lane road, and all these animals are hanging out there. Meanwhile, you got, you know, all these acres of woods, you know, 1,400 acres or something like that, I think the park is, and that doesn't include the Appalachian Trail, and they're not in the woods where they're supposed to be. They're on the outskirts away from the lake, which made no sense to me.
Well, if it's poisoned by nuclear crap, it makes sense that they don't go up by the water.
Yep. No, we were talking about that. Maybe they can detect the, you know, that exactly what you just mentioned, that there's some type of poisoning. You know, there's still some.
But Arizona, when me and Bill went the first time, I seen a lot of animal prints down in the mud, coyote and the raccoon, excuse me, and other animal footprints. So, you know, there are like beavers. You can see the beavers where they bit the trees down and everything. Yep. So there is life in that lake.
Okay.
And around that lake. Yeah. But that particular night, nothing came into that park except us. Except we were the only things in that park.
I mean, where we were, there should have been life. There's no question about it. You have a swamp there. You've got plenty of foliage. You got food. You got, you know. And granted, the nuclear disaster that was there and whatever they may or may not have cleaned up, but there should have been something there, and there definitely wasn't. It was dead space.
Wow.
And Al, if you remember, this goes back to the next day when you called me. When Al called me the next day, I had knew all this stuff happened. He calls me up and he's like, "Oh, it was a dud." And I was like, "Al, what are you talking about? Oh, we didn't get much. It was whatever." And he still sounded loopy. And I said, "Al, I know that you got something." And I was also affected by this, and I wasn't even there.
Yeah, yeah.
This energy, what I call, I think it's what most, the best word would be, it's disorienting.
Oh, absolutely. Disorienting. Yeah.
And your brain is confused. Your brain doesn't work right.
Well, it ungrounds you, and so you're like stoned.
Right. And it was the next week, you know, Al, you're calling me and you're going, "Oh my gosh, we got all this stuff. All this stuff happened." He said, "Why was I saying nothing happened?" I said, mm-hmm. "Because you guys were still confused, and I was to a certain extent for, you know, 3 or 4 days later." And I actually had incidents that happened, and I wasn't even there. Like I said, these scratch marks, you know, burn mark. I had a burn mark. I had also had a knot, and it was very strange because I was not even with them at the location. But he did. They woke up about a week later, you know, and I was like, "Oh my gosh, you know, we got all these things and all this stuff happened." And we discussed this, you know, several times. Why did they not remember? Why did he not remember that? You know, why did he come out there thinking nothing happened? So it was, this place is very, very strange. And this place is not like this all the time, by the way. Sometimes, I mean, well, let me walk that back. Mm-hmm. It is strange all the time, but there are certain times when it is.
When it's really strange.
Yes, yes. When, you know, everything comes together and you just really get a glimpse or walk into a completely different reality in this place. And when I was reading the place, I could see, like they were talking about these lights, I could see these lights and these orbs all in the trees, all in the bushes. I mean, it was crazy. It was like this whole forest was lit up with these light anomalies.
Right.
No. I was just going to say that it's kind of like, you know, when you're hearing these things, you're being watched right now. And she said at the last location, you know, you may actually have a Bigfoot-ish type creature or something come forward and more reveal itself. And like, so you're kind of anticipating. And we're wise enough. We don't let that play in our brain. We don't let it lock in. And, you know, sometimes the power of suggestion is really powerful.
Right.
We're not like that because we know that we're there. It's an investigation to look at it. But it's almost as if you have these different entities from different realms, different vibrations, and it's like a gigantic, it's like going to 11 if you're a Spinal Tap fan. I mean, it's just, it was incredible. It was probably one of the best experiences ever.
Well, I was going over my notes, and I had written in here that this place, basically, this was what I wrote down. This place was like every legend that you've ever heard, you know, worldwide, was in this place. And that's exactly, and what I'm, you know, every story or every legend, every creature, I mean, they were all, everything was there.
Well, the Indians called it sacred ground, from what I understand. Yes. And I think there's a very good reason why it was sacred ground.
Oh, absolutely. Definitely sacred ground. And I don't know if it has anything to do with the uranium that they were mining there that made it sacred. Because they see light anomalies to go in and out of the lake, little balls of light. They see UFOs hovering over the lake, siphoning water. I mean, a mile down the road, just to the south of it, is another lake called Whaley Lake. Yep. And a friend of mine, I was telling you the story. He was out fishing one night with one of his buddies doing night fishing out in the middle of the lake, and they seen this big, look like a spotlight, coming down the train tracks, and they just figured it was corrections officers, because there's a lot of correction facilities up here, and thinking maybe one of the inmates had escaped, and it was a helicopter, and then this light came right to them, and it was 12 o'clock at night when this light came to them, and these two guys are just sitting in this little rowboat fishing, and the next thing they know, it's 7 o'clock in the morning, they're laying on a beach, and they lost 7 hours of time, and those two guys went separate ways the following day, and they haven't spoken to each other in 20 years.
Wow.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Oh, and I just had a brain fart.
It's going to be when we all go back this spring. That's what I'm looking forward to, going back.
Bill can't get back there fast enough.
No, I would love to go up there with you guys. I might just ride my motorcycle up there, stay at Bill's one night, and party at the fire pit he just made, and then we can all go on a trip.
That's right. I mean, I would love to go up there myself. But I told Al, I was almost afraid to go in there with my empathic. And, you know, being an empath, and I mean, I'm not sure that I could handle it.
Well, that may be a little bit too intense.
If you go up there with protections,
everybody's, you're welcome.
If you go up there with protections, Cindy, then I don't see where there'd really be an issue. And by the way, I think for what you were talking about earlier that was going on with you, maybe you need to see a Reiki master, and I'll talk to you more about it later.
Oh, yes, I would love to talk to me about that. I would love to.
Anyway, the best thing about it is it was like Bill's very first paranormal investigation.
Right. And he
got to experience everything in one nutshell, one night. Well, and it was his idea. Halloween, Al. Hallow's Eve. The veil is the thinnest. Let's go to Nuclear Lake, you know? I mean, and I'll be honest with you, man. The energy in the place was so disorienting. I was surprised. I mean, it took every ounce of energy we had just to stay focused and do one experiment at a time. And I was really, you know, when it was all said and done, I was surprised that we were able to do as much as we did and got through it, you know?
Hey, you know what?
Why does the movie Blair Witch keep popping into my head all day long? That movie was crap. It was fake. But still, I mean, the right. creepiness of the story just reminds me of that movie.
Hey, the first time I seen those Karen things on the very first time we went there into those woods, and we seen those Karen things.
Yeah.
There wasn't just one on a 30-foot cliff like we seen. We seen a pretty big one. It was 2 feet tall, and it was on a 25-foot ledge. When I went in there the first time with my friends, when we did the first two Bigfoot investigations, because we did one during the day and one at night, when we went in during the day, those little things were all over the woods. Talk about being freaked out, man, because that's the first thing that popped into my head was Blair Witch. I was like, oh my God, what are these things doing here? What are these things, you know? Freaked me out, man.
Another thing that was unsettling is when we're walking down the path, when we went from the first location to the circle location, I found myself always looking back. It was like something was watching from a distance, and I couldn't stop from looking back. Now, yes, it could have been just the whole, you know, setting and everything that was going on, and just that was a natural thing to occur when you keep looking back because of the environment. But I got to tell you, I couldn't get that feeling out that something was watching us.
Well, Bryan, didn't you see that, like, that hairy leg on the way in? And Bryan kept looking back, and he kept saying, you guys don't see it, and neither one of us could see it. And Cindy said, you guys are all going to experience stuff, but experience the same thing, but see it differently. And I was like, how could we all experience the same thing, but experience it differently? It didn't make any sense to me. Well,
very
now
strange
I know.
When you're walking and you just catch something moving in the woods, and you see, originally it was like a brownish leg, it, you know, looked like a leg moving behind a tree, But there was one time I actually saw like something like almost like a white robe, and I'm maybe we're being followed by something or somebody. Why I don't know, but you know it is the Appalachian Trail. It's not the safest place on the planet, but you know, and that was how it started out for us. And then I kept seeing these things popping up, and look, you know, it looked like something was looking behind a stone wall. And then as we're leaving, or I went over to the stone wall. It's a pretty significant drop behind that stone wall, about 15 feet. So whatever it is, had to be big. And my eyes were not playing tricks. I was, you know, it's funny where I live in the city, and these guys are also from the city, and you kind of have to have like your city smarts about you, because right. You just got to be prepared for almost anything. And
yeah, you don't want to get jacked.
Yeah, no, and it's a really weird thing. So I'm always looking for like where's the entrances, what's moving, where's it going, and it's as soon as it comes, it goes.
And why really is it offensive. Called the Appalachian Trail, by the way? Do you know?
How the trail got its name, I honestly don't know.
Okay,
I know it goes from Maine to like Georgia or something like that. It's like 2,500 miles long.
Wow.
But you know, but how it originally got its name, I don't know. And I know people camp, they walk it the whole summer long, like college kids. From what I understand, they'll start like in Maine and they'll go all the way down south, and then they'll hike all the way back up. And like I was telling you, the way I knew about the lake. I used to take my son there fishing when we were kids. When he was small, we never ate anything out of the lake. We just threw everything back. Had a beautiful German Shepherd. I used to take him hiking up the trail all the time. Never had any funky experience. Never had felt any funky energy. And then my neighbor came to me and told me the story about the two hunters that were hunting coon hunting at night, and they came out to they were on the Appalachian Trail, and they came out to where the nuclear lake, that campsite is, and they had these two big red bone coon hounds. And they started getting rocks thrown at them. And, you know, one of the hunters thought it was, you know, high school kids partying and hanging out at the campsite. And he told them, you know, stop throwing rocks, otherwise I'm going to sick the dogs on you. And then another rock would come. And every time the rock came out, it would be a little bit bigger than the first one. And eventually they sicked the dogs on this, thinking it was the kids. The dogs took off. They got about 20 feet. And then they put their tails between their legs, and they ran back to the truck. And these two hunters are like, you know, these are local boys, you know? And they're like, what the hell? You know, they've been hunting these boys all their lives. So another rock comes at them. So then one of the hunters says, okay, listen, next time you throw a rock, I'm going to put a round into the tree. You know, we're gonna stop playing this game. And another rock came out. The guy puts a round in the tree. Now you got to understand, these guys are coon hunting. They got small guns, 22 caliber.
Yeah.
Nothing big, nothing powerful. It's not bringing down a black bear or anything like that. And all of a sudden, and this is their words, not mine, they told my neighbor, they said, man, a 9-foot Sasquatch stepped out from behind that tree and gave us a flex scream. You know, something like the Incredible Hulk. He flex screamed, he said, and we just turned and ran, and we went back to our trucks and we got the hell out of there. One of the guys will never go back hunting on that trail again on that side of the woods. The other guy did go back a month later, and as soon as he came out to that same point, the rock started coming at him again, and he knew right away it was going down, and he just got the dog and he hauled ass out of there. That's why I wanted to make that our last location for the night, because what's ever going to that spot is coming off of that trail. You know what I mean? Because I hiked that trail at night. We did a Sasquatch a hunt one night, and I'm telling you, it's a pretty squatchy trail. It's got ridge lines above you on one side to the north of you, and hollers down below you to the south of you, and a swamp in between. And the swamp is full of life. The night we were there, we had something following us. We smelt it. Everybody on the team smelt it. Everybody seen the broken branches that were twisted. I had two of my guys come up to me and tell me they felt like they were being watched.
What if the squatches have deemed that their territory and they're just trying to get you to leave their home?
Yeah, yeah, and that's probably what it is. You know what I mean? But we're looking for them, man. We want to see them. And I had my night vision goggles, And everybody, and even I, had the same vibe that it was coming from the ridgeline. And I looked up and down that ridgeline with my night vision goggles, and I didn't see anything. I had this huge mag flashlight on me, and I hit the ridgeline with the flashlight, and I was looking for eye shine, just trying to catch anything. We didn't see anything. We eventually crossed over the swamp, and we got closer to the lake. I would say maybe a quarter mile to the lake, and we were all like taking a break on the other side of the swamp, just taking a water break, when all of a sudden the coyotes went insane and started running in all directions like they were being hunted. Okay, I mean, they were just running for their lives. I had a coyote run over my feet. He was the size of a German Shepherd, and this thing was running for its life. And it was just, at that point, all my friends that I were with, because they were all city people, they were like, okay, let's pack it up, let's go home, I'm done, you know. It's just too freaky, because, you know, some people, there's people out there that claim Bigfoot hunts with these coyotes and takes their kills and yada, yada, yada. But that night, and the same night when we were there that night, if you guys remember, at the end of the night, the coyotes started going yelping and running around like they were being hunted again. They were like screaming, yep. And they were just running in all directions, and we could hear them running on the other side of the woods. And they weren't running like they were hunting a deer, you know, like in a pack. They were running like something was hunting them. It was crazy, man.
It sounds like it was insane.
Oh, it was. And that tree that Bill was talking about on the way in, the first time we went in there during the day, up that tree, and it's like a telephone pole straight up for 60 feet, and then it branches off into these huge, like, oak branches, okay? And the first time we went in there, I seen a buck carcass, a full-grown buck, like a six-pointer, up on that branch, hanging over the top of that branch. That branch had to be a good 60 feet above the ground. Now, I know mountain lions carry their kill up in trees to protect it from other animals.
Yeah,
but 60 feet straight up, you know what I mean? 60 feet
straight up for a mountain lion. A mountain lion doesn't have the ass to pull a deer up that high and put it on a branch.
Yeah, especially a big buck. You're talking about a 150-pound buck.
Yeah.
This thing was just laying over the tree branch like somebody laid it over there. I'll come back for it later.
Hey, warning.
Bill C.
Oh, there you go. There, a warning. It's like a warning to say this is what's going to happen to you if you keep messing with my home.
I'm not buying that at all. I don't think it was a warning. I just think it may have been a kill from the night before, and we just stumbled across it that following morning. But the place has just got all kinds of high strangeness going on there, from night light anomalies to UFOs to Bigfoots. Just, I mean, everything. Sacred native land and the Appalachian Trail and, like, you know, military mining uranium. God, you know, who the hell knows what's going on in those mountains?
Well, here's an idea. What is the name of the Native Americans that had that land that made it sacred?
I'm not sure if it was the Iroquois or the Mohegans, the Mohawks, or something like that. They were all on the eastern part of the United States, northeastern part of the United States.
I would try to find that.
Algonquin as well.
I would try to find that out, and then I would try to talk with some of the elders about that land and see what they said.
Man, if I could find a tribe and some of their elders, I would love to sit down with them and pick their brains. It would be my pleasure. It's just that they're, you know, what they do is they come around once or twice a year in the summer, and they have those tribal powwows.
Right.
Yeah, you have to hook up with them then. That's the only time they're around anymore. Well, it's not like they have reservation.
Seems to me it would be worth the effort.
Oh, absolutely.
We'll definitely look into that. I have a couple of professors I know that teach Native American history or history of North American Indian peoples. But one of the things about the Appalachian Trail, and I did find out, it's part of the Appalachian Mountain Ridge, which goes, you know, that's basically, that's where the trail is going through.
That's probably how it got its name.
Yeah. Most likely, that's the cause of the name, because it sticks, because it cuts through so much. But you have to understand, Bigfoot sightings along this actual trail in these areas, it's like a freeway for these animals or creatures or whatever you want to call it. A lot of this, that whoop sound is the same whoop sound you hear down in Kentucky. And it's, you know, if something can travel that fast, to go from point A to point B, a real distance, probably doesn't take that much.
Right.
So, it, you know, it's a great food source, common trail, people walking through it. I mean, it may, you know, may not want you going through their living room, but, you know, it's a great thoroughfare for these type of creatures.
Well, let me tell you something. I was never a big fan of the Bigfoot interdimensional creature theory, okay? Never bought it, wasn't buying it.
I never bought that either, Al.
You couldn't sell it to me, okay?
I never bought that one either.
After that night, when that thing went from 30 feet below us to 2 miles away in a blink of an eye, I mean, I don't give a shit how fast you're running through those woods. We would have heard it taking down trees, because a friend of mine recently had a sighting in Pennsylvania while he was hunting, and he had a Bigfoot come out of the swamp and run up to the top of the mountain. He heard a tree knock, and then 2 minutes later, he heard a Bigfoot barreling up the mountain, and he said it sounded like a freight train. Wow. And whatever was underneath us that night and then was 2 miles away from us in like 30 seconds, that I said, well, maybe, you know what, just maybe these things are interdimensional, because I can't imagine anything moving that much, that distance, that quickly.
Well, I would think, because that's their home, they know every nook and cranny of that area, and they know how to be loud, and they know how to be dead quiet so they can hunt and catch their food. So, you know, I mean, maybe they could be interdimensional, or maybe they could step in and out of time, or they just know how to be really super quiet.
I know, man, but that's a great distance to go through with all that leaf litter and everything on the ground. I mean, to not make a sound, not even a sound. Like Bill said, we never heard anything walk away from us, only come towards us. And then the sound would just disappear out of thin air.
Well, you know, also, when I was reading this site, I told Al, I kept seeing these creatures disappearing and reappearing. And they would just be there 1 second and they were gone the next. So I'm not sure how to explain that, but I don't believe that they are a creature that's been hiding from us in the woods, a genuine creature like an ape or something. I have read a lot of these Bigfoot. Arkansas, we have them here in Arkansas.
Right.
And I do not pick that up at all. This is some type of spiritual being. This is some type of being that is able, maybe they're able to step out of phase. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah,
we just don't
I understand what you're saying.
We don't know how to do it or something like that. But that, they most definitely have this ability to disappear and reappear.
Well, that would be one great hunting technique, don't you think?
Absolutely.
Oh, yes. Yes.
I mean,
and you know, there have been many reports of these things disappearing in front of people's eyes while they're standing there looking at them. There's also been reports that they have disappeared in a white light.
You know, and I've heard stories of Native Americans thought they were supernatural. They were in flesh and
right.
blood.
Yeah,
right.
They just appear and then they go away. I mean, they appear out of smoke and their fires, and it's
right.
Yeah,
the only time, the only time I've ever come close to anything about Bigfoot is there's a campground up near Cleveland, Ohio, and it's all state forest land. And I was looking down from the rest area where people can enjoy the scenery and all this. And I'm looking down in the valley, and there's an upright tree. I mean, this tree's got to be 20, 30 feet high, and the roots are facing up, and the top of the tree is stuck in the hole where the roots were. And I know Bigfoot does that, but that's the closest I've ever come to it. So
Is that Fork Lake Park or something like that, right?
No,
I've heard of that park.
It's that park is closer to this other park resort type. It's a great big, they've got all these cabins, and they go down that one river in their canoes and do all this other kind of stuff. I forget the name of it. I forgot to ask Kelly what the hell that name was.
And I know the only time I've ever heard of Bigfoots doing that was the Bigfoots that were in Alaska. I never heard anything out in the Pacific Northwest or anything on the eastern seaboard, northeast, doing that with trees. Twisting and bending, and yeah, absolutely, but actually uprooting them and turning them upside down and planting them back in, that's a pretty powerful creature, man.
And that's a pretty powerful statement, too.
Yeah.
If you think about it, that's like, look, stay the hell away from us, otherwise we're just going to kill you. I don't know if they would be that violent of a species. They just, you know, it's just like everybody else. I want to live my life, stay the hell out of my apartment, or out of my house. Everything's good.
Well, I was told that they did that to mark their territory.
Oh, I believe it. Absolutely, yeah.
That's a nice marker.
Yeah, it certainly is. That one, man.
Yeah.
You know, these creatures were violent. They've had plenty of chances because the first thing a lot of people do is shoot at them.
Absolutely.
I mean, you would not believe how many people, hunters have guns, because the hunters are the most likely people to run across these things, is they shoot at them. You know, and they did a whole show, and I don't know if you saw it, where a guy supposedly said he killed one.
In Texas? Was that the Texas guy?
Yeah. And they went back there, and you know, he was trying to, he showed them where because he said he had buried the carcass and couldn't remember where it was.
Yeah, he was on Art Bell, I believe.
Yeah, well, and they did a whole thing on History Channel on this guy, and I thought, why would you shoot this thing? They got a lot of negative, very negative email, and not only the show, but this guy about shooting this Bigfoot, whether it was true or not, people were actually very mad about it. I don't buy the story personally because you don't remember, you kill a Bigfoot, you don't take anything, you don't tell anybody, you don't bring any of it, and then you don't remember where you shot it, you don't remember where it's buried.
The night I heard him on Art Bell.
Little fact for you guys, it's on the forest registry. Somewhere on the registry, this was told to me by an FBI agent, that the federal government doesn't acknowledge the Bigfoot exists, but it's on the federal forest registry that if you kill one, it's a $10,000 fine and I think 5 years in jail.
That's what I heard.
For an animal that doesn't exist.
I heard that. I heard that when I was living in Arizona. And to answer the other part of where we talk about that guy, when he was on Art Bell, I didn't believe that story then.
Right.
So.
Right. And that's why I was surprised that anyone wasted a TV show on the idiot, to be honest.
Have you seen some of these TV shows? I mean, some of these TV shows are really freaking stupid,
Oh, they are. Yeah, that's right. True. I should have known. I thought, well, this is absolutely ridiculous.
I mean, the fact of the matter is that if you were to take down a Bigfoot, let's say, you'd easily be able to cover that $10,000 fine because there's a boatload of money coming your way.
Oh, yeah.
And that's a fact. But I believe a long time ago, I heard something, maybe the Pacific Northwest, where it literally, you will be charged with murder if you take out a Bigfoot.
In the state of New Jersey, they will charge you with murder.
New Jersey.
In Whitehall, New York, they will charge you with murder if you do that, if you shoot a Bigfoot.
Isn't that strange?
Whitehall's got them protected, yeah.
On a creature that no one admits exists. So that's pretty telling.
Yeah, I think that's pretty telling. Absolutely, yeah. I told my friend who's seen it, who was a non-believer. Arizona, when I tell you, this guy didn't believe in Jack. He was a non-believer. And when he seen this thing come barreling up the hill, he said its legs were the size of tree trunks. He said it, and he was sitting there with a .30-06 in his hand, and he said he didn't think the gun would even slow it down. He said, and when he got to the top of the mountain where it was rocky, it just leaped from one rock to the other like a monkey going up a tree. He said, it never slowed down. He said, it was amazing. He said, there's no doubt in his mind now today, because I've been telling him this for 40 years. I'm telling you, man, if you've seen it with your own two eyes, you'd believe what I've seen. But I can't make you believe something that you haven't seen yet. But, well, you know, and I tell you what, talk to the dude now, and he'll tell you they exist.
Yeah, I have no doubt. I haven't had any doubt in my mind that they've existed even when I was a child. I always knew that they existed. I've just never been. I always had this fantasy that I could be the one that walks in, because when you're laying in bed and you got all this stuff going through your mind. It's like, well, because of my spiritual stuff and all this, and I bet you I could make my vibration so a Bigfoot would come down and sit next to me and I could talk to him. But
I know exactly what you're talking about.
You know what I'm talking about, don't you?
I've been there with you.
Yeah. Yeah, I know it's asinine to think that, but
it's really, there's been stories though of little children that weren't afraid of the Bigfoot, and the Bigfoot, they've been playing, camping. I know I've seen a couple of stories, and they said yeah, it came down, and we kind of, I don't know if it was a full adult size Bigfoot, but there was an interaction there, and that's where I always got that, like, well, if they could do it, I could do it, you know.
Yeah,
but I just have rocks thrown at me by Bigfoot. That's pretty much it.
Well, that's more I've had happen to me with Bigfoot, so kudos to you.
You'll come out next time with us.
Yeah, yeah.
Last but not least, getting back to the investigation, is that Bryan and Bill and myself have sat down and discussed this missing time, these 2 hours, and although I'm not a big fan of hypnotic regression, we all agreed that we would do it in this one case just to find out what happened in those 2 hours. You know, now I'm just trying to find somebody who can do all of us at the same time, you know, all on the same day, and then, you know,
charge you $10,000.
not charge you $10,000, but try to, whatchamacallit, try to put our stories together and see if they all coexist, you know, if we all say the same thing, you know. I mean, like I said, I would never want to do that in my life. Never, ever did I ever consider it. But this is the one time. But only if those other guys do it with me, you know, that I would be willing to do it just to see what the hell happened.
Yeah, I've got a problem with shrinks and doing past regression stuff, too. I don't think I want to do that.
Yeah.
Only for this one time. For this one time I would do it. Otherwise,
we wanted to keep it together. You know, we wanted to keep... This would be for us, not for the general public. To, you know, it's just the questions you have in your mind, like what happened, did something happen, did something not happen, just to see. Well, but sometimes, you know, when you leave sleeping dogs lie, you know, maybe we should just leave it alone for the time being.
No, I mean,
maybe
yeah, you want to leave it alone. I totally get it.
I mean, do you really want to like pay some shrink $3,000 to find out you had an alien probe your behind, you know?
Oh, not at all. No, I personally don't believe in them that much, and I think a lot of people, if they had some solid, really solid friends in their lives that I knew I grew up with, you know, you can probably get away with like talking to them. But I don't need to pay anybody to tell them my problems or anything like that.
Okay,
I'm just really dying. I don't know. Is it a combination of just the energy in the place that had us so confused, and all the stuff that we experienced that made time go by so quickly? Or was there another underlying factor that we just can't remember?
Well,
you know,
2 hours is a long time to lose. That's a long time.
And it just doesn't seem like, even though we had a lot of shit go down, that it would, that the 2 hours would go by that quick, even if we were so encurled with the, you know, the 12-foot shadows and the little shadows and the light anomalies and the people walking in the woods and all that stuff and the red fog and the blue mist and everything that happened. I mean, even if you add all of that stuff up, could it have taken 2 hours for all that stuff to happen?
It was a blink of an eye. That's what it felt like. A blink of an eye. There was no way. We were just like, what are you talking about? It's 11:30. It was just this time. There's no way. that's how confident we were in what we're stating. And it put a little, you know, knock.
Yeah, and I wasn't accusing Bill of being a liar, but I just couldn't believe that you know, we had lost 2 hours of time, you know. And he's like, Al, I swear.
Well, what's real strange about this is I am not able to read what happened. And what happened to them are these 2 hours. I mean, at all, period. And when I wrote my notes down, the very last line I wrote in my notes was, I am missing something, 3 or 4 underlines. I felt like that there was something that I was missing in the reading, whether I was blocked or, but I felt like even then that I was missing a big part that I couldn't read.
Well, if they stepped into the moment, that would cut your connection.
Right, I really have no idea, and normally I should have some type of idea what happened, but I really do not have any idea what happened.
Right.
With that 2 hours.
That's the best I can think of with your connection deal is, if you step right into the moment, and then everything in outside the moment disconnects from you, and you are in the moment. The moment is the area in between,
right,
what's going to happen, what has happened, and where you're at right now. It's like a veil, but it's not the veil. It's more of a void. And
I understand what you're saying. That does make sense.
And more of 2 hours.
Well, I'm trying to explain it so that they understand it. It's like, okay, walking into a picture. Nothing moves except for you. You are the only thing that's sentient in that picture, because everything else is frozen, and that's what the moment is.
Right.
And then you step forward, and you end up going through time regular. If you step backwards, then it's like deja vu, and you're going through it all over again.
Gotcha.
Right. I mean, that makes perfect sense. I mean, perfect sense, because I knew somehow when I was doing this reading that there was going to be something, whatever, that happened that I was not going to be able to read. That's what that sentence meant, that I'm missing something.
And that,
because
and that's
I could
the,
felt like I was going to miss something, and I told, you know, Al asked me about it, and I told him, I said, I really don't know.
Yeah, that's
and one
the,
thing
that's
about the, me, I'm sorry, is I'm honest. I'll always tell you what I feel, no matter, you know, no matter whether you don't want to hear it or not.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, yes. Brian, go ahead.
No, and that is true. I mean, you know, that's all of us. I'm going to tell you, if someone's asking me to look at a photo of what do you think this is, what do you think that is, I'm telling you straight up, I'm not here to, you know, I'm not going to BS anybody. That's a light, that's not a UFO, it's a reflection, it's this, it's that, or this is what my opinion is of it. So I'll tell you straight up, you're not going to like it sometimes, and sometimes you're going to be more questions coming at me. But you know, the whole thing is, that's what we're thinking about, is what happened in that moment where we were disconnected from Cindy, and where were we doing?
Yeah.
Were we there? Were we allowed to go into that moment? Was that where we were? Did they open up the moment for us to walk into, to say, you're now here? Did they say something to us? Did they do anything? Did we just go into that, an ether? You know, so that's where our questions are.
Well,
and it's very interesting about the whole thing is that even today, I mean, we'll look back and you'll think about it, and you catch little bits and pieces start coming back every once in a while. And Al and I always have, you know, conversations about, you know, like, do you remember this part or that part? It just starts, you know, things are starting to get filled back in a little bit.
Well, maybe they opened the doorway for you to cross into so they could observe you, because you didn't know what was going on, so you were going to act like it wasn't like you were having your parents stand over you so you act one way, and so they wanted to open that doorway up. You step into the moment, you didn't know what was going on, they wanted to see what you were going to do, and that way they could control the situation had you been one of those people who was out to destroy things or something, because they don't know.
Right.
Right. No. That's a great theory, and it's, you know, it's from that point, like, what did they observe us with, and what are they going to do thereafter? Because if you have an entity or a being or something that has the ability to do that, then there's zero control in your life for them not to do it again someplace else, or down the line, or 6 weeks from now, or a year. So we'll find out when we head back up there.
Well, I blame it all on Bill, because he was the one who wanted to go in the first place.
Yeah, it's all Bill's fault.
And I'm dying to go back again.
I have to say, though, that Bill's very brave. Most people that would go out on an investigation and have all this stuff happen the very first investigation would have ran off screaming. I mean, really wanted to go home and just really would want no more part of it. So I have to say, you're pretty brave.
Well, you know what? When you encounter something like this and so many things happen, you have questions and you have more questions and you're just more curious. Yes.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And you want to seek these answers. You know, I am, it's a lot of it's unresolved. And unfortunately, due to the situation, we didn't record the whoops when they happened and some of the other things. But I can guarantee you, the next time we all go in there, we're going to be better prepared.
You know, that's one of the things I first said when we got back out. I said, from this point forward, the minute we leave the car, we will be recording until we get back to the car. Yep. And if it has to be audio or video, any way we have to, I want to have a recording so we have a two-hour burst. If we can mark it, that'd be great. This way we can just, at least we'll have something. And we don't have to worry about the, you know, the errors. I mean, we had, you know, there's always technical difficulties.
It's a lot of hard drive space.
Well, you know, I was thinking about it beforehand, but we were talking to another person, and they mentioned GoPros, and I have one of those. It's just, you know, sometimes the batteries don't last that long. That's the problem. So I'm thinking at least having an audio recorder 24/7, catching whatever I can catch, and then maybe I just ordered some of these GoPro-like things from China. So I'm thinking on the, you know, putting it on the front of each person and the back, at least four people.
And I bought a night vision camera myself. And but you know what, we could sit here and talk about all the shit that we're gonna do and this, that, and the other thing, and then as soon as we get in there and we get hit with that energy again, and we're right back in the red fog, you know what I mean? Yep. So I mean, you know, we had a game plan going in, you know.
Well, I have an idea with you. You take Cindy with you, and when you start feeling like this, she teaches, she shows you and helps you to ground so that you aren't having your heads up in the clouds.
Yeah, I'm working on that with her.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. You have to stop and actually ground yourself and see yourself. And the way that I do it is I see actual vines or branches coming out of the ground and moving up my legs, where I'm completely grounded. You know, and then this, you have to do that in situations, and it's hard because sometimes you don't remember to even try to do it.
Yeah, especially, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I mean, Al's right about that.
The energy at that place, we're going to even remember how to do it or even attempt to do it.
Well, that's why she needs to be with you, so she can constantly remind you to do that. You know?
I mean, yeah, well, if you would have heard her, she sounded like she had Bell's palsy.
I was going to say, I may not be much help. Right, I couldn't even speak.
I mean, it could be a different situation. It's funny because when we revealed this to some of the other members of the BPS, one of them said, well, I would have just ran after it. I'm like, you can't play armchair quarterback. When the situation hits, it hits. And you react the way you can react. So we always have one Cindy there. I mean, it'd make it a lot easier.
And to our defense, Bryan, we did run towards it. We jumped that wall and we ran to the sea. It's not that we ran away. It's just that once we got over that wall, there was nothing there to see. Yeah,
try running through the pitch black. I mean, like literally pitch black.
Right off a 30-foot cliff.
Yeah, I mean, it would have been a really interesting experience and probably, like, you know, a rescue situation.
Yeah, last time I went out at night doing a Bigfoot investigation, I dislocated my shoulder. So I don't want to deal with that ever again.
Yeah.
That was no fun.
Yeah,
physical therapy and everything else, that's no fun.
I've been through a dislocated shoulder, but it's no fun at all.
Nope.
So anyhow, it's been an awesome 2 hours. Do you guys
want to? It's been fun, man. No doubt about it.
Do you want to continue? We can continue. If you guys are done, then we can maybe have another interview another night. I would love to have you guys back. So what do you want to do?
Well, yeah, I think also when we go back to Nuclear Lake, a follow-up would definitely be awesome to do.
Oh, well, yeah, that goes without saying, man.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for inviting us.
Oh, well, you're very, very welcome. Thank you very much for being on the show.
I definitely appreciate it. And, you know, we'll be broadcasting, and we're going to try to broadcast live, so we'll give you the feed to that so you can, if you want to follow along, or we're going to try to stream it, so hopefully that will work.
Okay.
Okay. Arizona, it's been a pleasure, man. Thank you very much for having us.
And it's been a pleasure for us. So say goodnight, guys. And yeah, say goodnight, guys.
Goodnight. Goodnight, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Talk to you guys tomorrow.
And yep. Ciao. Everybody out there in the chat room, be well, be safe. Thanks for being here. Thanks for listening to the show. Without you guys, there wouldn't be any reason for me to be here. And I will see you bye.
Later.
Well, she crashed into my backyard in a saucer from outer space. And when she took off her space helmet, she had the most beautiful face. She said, take me to your leader. I said, why don't you come inside? And when she said she came in peace, I knew I needed her to be mine. Well, she said she'd been to Earth before, but covered it up, and her ancestors built Stonehenge and the pyramids and other stuff. She was on her way to Venus, but her space